to kind of summarize what we did last time we were here, because it was a week ago, so it's been a while. We started by talking about the labor theory of value and the subjective value that goods and services have. So the labor theory of value is what economists originally thought. I think what's what a lot of people naturally think is that the cost that it takes to produce a good or service has something to do with its value, or even is entirely its value. And for a lot of us, it makes intuitive sense. This is something that we can understand. It's very basic, and it has, you know, it's a concrete standard rather than subjective value, which, you know, every person values it differently. So how can you say that there's any value inherent in this good? How can you compare two different goods or one good to two different people? So even though it's more complicated, like I gave that example of having, water the morning after homecoming when you're hungover as hell, it's a lot more valuable then than it is, you know, on a regular Tuesday afternoon. So at different times or different people, they value goods differently. And there was that problem with the diamond water paradox I talked about, where classical economists, using the labor theory of value, couldn't figure out why diamonds were more expensive than water. And it was that subjective value and idea of marginal analysis, where you're looking at the next unit of that good or service that you're getting, that helps us understand first the diamond water paradox, but then in general, like, why people value goods differently, why some people don't want to pay a particular price for a good, why some want to pay a lower price and refuse to pay that higher price, why some people are willing to pay an exorbitant amount of money for something and very few other people are. And then we started to get into the market, so we looked at the role of prices. So the question we're trying to answer, and why I expanded this kind of introduction section, which is this kind of like a little bit of information in the textbook, is because this is the heart of what we're trying to understand here. We're trying to understand, how do we decide to create all these things? How do we decide how many to make, what to make, who's going to make it, who's going to end up buying it and using them? This is a really difficult question, especially because there's no overarching central planner. There's not one person who's in charge of determining all this stuff. It's people doing it on their own, or, you know, working together with a, in general, small group of people. Even a giant company like Amazon is small compared to all the consumers that exist out there. One thing that helps businesses figure out what to make it out of, is prices. So prices tell each producer or each potential entrepreneur how valuable something is. So you can see the value of its relative uses. So you can use, out of wood in a whole bunch of different uses. If what you're going to make out of it isn't going to bring you that much money, you're not going to be willing to pay a high price for it. Because again, it's not that valuable. People aren't willing to pay that high of a price for it. They don't put that much value on what you're doing, on whatever good you're creating with that. So you're not going to be able to pay a lot for that wood. But some other use that's extremely valuable to people will be more than happy to pay that higher price. So you end up, because of prices, we end up with the most valuable goods and services for consumers. So yeah, the example I gave last time, the very end of class, was from the episode of It's Always Sunny, when the gang hits the slopes. You've seen that episode. There's this old ski lodge. It was called like Party Mountain. It was real popular in the 80s, but like it went downhill, and it really sucks by the time they go here in this episode. Frank comes in, he buys it, and he ends up fracking the mountain. It didn't have a lot of use as a ski lodge anymore, but it did have a lot of valuable natural resources under there. These natural resources that were much more valuable to consumers than a crappy, you know, falling apart ski lodge. Because of prices, because he saw the high value he could get for all the natural gas he fracked from the mountain, he had incentive to go out, purchase that, and then provide those goods to to consumers or whether like businesses to make goods, ending up making people better off. Remember, price serves two functions. It's both a signal, so it tells Frank, hey, there's this profit opportunity here. People are gonna want this. They like it more than what this place is currently doing. And it's incentive, because he wants to make money. People wanna make themselves better off. So it incentivizes them to go out and provide good things for other people. And this goes all the way back to Adam Smith, who talked about how the market works. He was the first one to try to figure out what the hell was going on. Why do people spend their time providing goods and services for other people? Of course, we do it where you get a job. Why am I here? I could say I'm here because I love teaching or some shit like that, but really it's because I'm getting paid to do this. Hopefully this is making you guys better off. If it's not making you guys, not preparing you any better for your career, at least you're getting that piece of paper at the end, like, you know, checking off the requirement, one step closer to getting a job. But because I'm being paid to make you guys better off, it's as if I'm doing this purely out of, you know, benevolence, that I'm a really good guy sacrificing myself for you. But in reality, I'm making myself better off. And the beauty of markets is how we have most of the time, and we'll talk about sometimes later on when this doesn't hold true, but most of the time, you're rewarded for making someone else better off. And when you have those incentives that you do what's best for you, and it's also what's best for the other person you're dealing with, we're able to create goods and services that make people better off. You end up increasing the happiness, the benefit, the utility, whatever word we want to use, we make society better off, make it better. I think you can imagine a society, or you can imagine situations where making yourself better off makes other people worse off. Markets are normally what we call positive sum instead of zero sum. So a zero sum transaction or a zero sum situation is when, to make myself better off, I make one of you guys worse off. So I walk over here and I steal Glenn's laptop. I'm better off. If the school didn't just like give you a new one for free, you would be worse off. But in a positive sum situation, there's something wrong with his. He pays me to fix the laptop. I don't know what kind of sites you've been on lately, but got downloaded some viruses or something from it. I fixed that. He's now made himself better off. I've now got cash in my pocket. So we're both better off. And that's the beauty of the market. Yeah, and I think we talked about this is what we ended with. The important thing I want to hit again is that, remember from earlier, there's a lack of knowledge in society. We don't have all the knowledge of what we need. We don't know every single person, like their needs, their wants, what they value. But we can use prices to aggregate this knowledge. So we can find out if a good is popular or not, or if it's, if there's too much of it. So if the price starts increasing because it's flying off the shelves, it's a signal to producers that, hey, this is really valuable, people like this, encourages them to produce more. They don't need to know which individual people like it. They don't need to take a poll of every single person. Do you like this or do you not like it? They get this knowledge from prices and how prices change. So we're not sure, we see a price increase, we're not 100% sure why it changes. So if the price of milk increases, it could be there's an increase or a decrease in supply. Maybe there was a drought. A lot of cows were underfed, they produce less milk. Maybe there was mad cow disease because some brainiacs thought that feeding cows parts of other cows wouldn't result in any problems. Maybe there's an increase in demand. Maybe a lot more people are drinking milk because of those Got Milk campaigns. Maybe more people want to eat cheese. So there's more uses for milk than just as milk itself, using other dairy products. Maybe that's why it went up. All the millennials, you know, they love their charcuterie boards now that they're getting older. It used to be what? Everyone loved pizza, Netflix, and wine. That was like every single dating profile for a while. But now they're like moving on to charcuterie, like getting a little bit, millennials are getting older, they're getting a little bit fancier now. But maybe more people want cheese. Your not 100% sure why the price is changing. Very difficult to aggregate this information, even for a giant company like Amazon or Google, or for the government even, because there's so much going on. But firms see the price increase for milk, so they're able to get some of this knowledge and do it much cheaper, much easier than if they went out and asked every single person what's going on. Yeah, so the market, don't think of it as one individual, like a place or a time or like one transaction. It's a process that's constantly occurring. It's going over and over again, all these people acting in their own self-interest. And by making themselves better off, almost always, they make the other party they're dealing with better off. We're gonna talk about supply and demand later. We're gonna work with that model in the next chapter. I don't have any markers on me today. But it's literally just two curves crossing each other. When I was first taking economics, when I was an undergrad, like it made intuitive sense to me, but a couple of my classmates that, they didn't start as econ majors, but they became econ majors, were like, yeah, like I saw that and that model like opened my eyes. I'm like, oh, this all makes sense now. And I was like, I mean, good, it's useful, but I don't, it's not really clicking for me. It took a couple years until I watched a lecture by Israel Kirzner talking about the market as a process. So the supply and demand curves we'll be working with later aren't constant, they're not set in stone. They're constantly moving as people's needs change, as they discover new information through these market interactions, through talking with other people, through new memes starting. I mean, think of how many people bought GameStop after the whole thing on Reddit blew up. Just new things, new information, changing people's minds, changing their behavior. Now for the market, we'll be looking at commerce. We'll be looking at people buying and selling goods. We'll look at firms creating these goods, entrepreneurs starting new firms, trying to meet consumer needs. So like I said, in the proper institutional setting, so when, in things like the market in general, acting in your own self-interest benefits all of society. It's as if you're doing something for others when really you're doing it for yourself. Of course, we're all not perfectly selfish. We're not all like clones of Ayn Rand. We do get happy helping other people, seeing friends and family prosper or do well or be happy. So in our own self-interest, sometimes the other person's well-being is in that. I'm sure there's a lot of like small local businesses that you guys like to patronize, whether it's around here, or like from where you're from, where they actually take care of you. They want you to do well. You go buy a case or two of beer at Falcini's and they'll give you a free bag of chips. They stay safe this weekend. Like they're definitely, they had some interest in you being happy. But with this profit motive, you don't have to rely on just people being good. You have people, even if they're bad, or even if they're ambivalent towards you, they still end up acting as if they care about you and want you to do well. And we'll talk about times, like I mentioned later, where the institutional setting isn't perfect, where there's problems, and people acting in their own self-interest end up hurting other people. And then we'll talk about, you know, different remedies for that. Now there's some requirements for these situations where people acting in their own self-interest benefits all of society, benefits others within society. There's things like property rights. You have to be secure in what you own, so you're not worried about someone coming in and stealing it from you later. Again, Adam Smith, it was either The Wealth of Nations or The Theory of Moral Sentiments. I had to read this in grad school. And he said something about the, if you took all the buried treasure in England and added it up, we could pay off the national debt five times over. I remember like, I don't know, growing up, watching like movies or kids' cartoons, there's like, they look people looking for buried treasure, finding it in fields and stuff. Apparently that was a real thing in England because they didn't have secure property rights. Someone could come in and steal your gold, so if you were rich, you'd bury it in your backyard somewhere. But if you die before you tell anyone, you can't tell anyone because then, you know, people know about it, they'll come and take it. So if you're worried about someone coming in, you're not don't have secure property rights, you're not going to do things to improve society. Nowadays, a person would put in a bank where it could be lent out. They would invest in a company, help that company grow and hire more people. You know, positive things for society. In the past, they're wasting it, just burying it. So property rights are important. Also, if there's no property rights, I can come in, I can steal stuff from you, make myself better off. You could steal stuff from me. Then we just end up fighting with each other all the time and taking each other's stuff. Again, not making society better off, not making each other better off. Along with that part is the rule of law. So you need a government that's able to enforce the law and enforce property rights. That if you're wronged, you know that you can go to the court, you can take the party that wronged you and be made whole again. And people know that they'll be punished for violating the law, for doing something that harms another person. In general, we need peace, a lack of violence, lack of war going on around us. And last one is efficient government. Something that's not wasteful, that's not taking a ton of resources from people. Generally fairly low taxes. Rather than really high taxes for a wasteful, bloated budget. Again, you could be like one of the Nordic countries that has much higher tax rates than the US and still be a good, efficient government, but if you're not wasting a ton of money on stupid things. And they tend not to waste a lot of money on stupid things, which is why they're able to have higher taxes, still have good governance. An example of different institutional settings leading to different outcomes is the old Oxford University and Glasgow University. And I don't think I wrote down which is which, so I'm just gonna make up. And odds are I'm gonna be wrong if you try to look this up later. But in Oxford University, they were paid by the university, the lecturers. And Glasgow, they were paid by the students themselves. So at Oxford University, the professors didn't really care about how good their lectures were. Imagine it's a big university now, like Penn State, where the professor's there to do research and teaching is just kind of like a side annoyance thing they have to do. So you have the lecture hall with like 1,000 students and they're up there half-assing it and then having the TA come in and like finish off the rest. Kind of what you had at Oxford University at the time. They're being paid by the administration. They don't really care about how good their lecture is. Meanwhile, at Glasgow, they're paid either by students or by how many students are taking their class. So the lecturers tried to do a really good job. They tried to make it interesting and funny, something that I fail at all the time. And they tried to make it valuable, like knowledge that students actually needed. So because the way the incentives were set up at Glasgow, you ended up with better lectures, you ended up with students that enjoyed it more than you got at Oxford University at the time, because they're just paid to be there. Now the market, this coordination of all people, is an example of what's called meta-coordination. Sounds really fancy, but it's simple. It's people acting in their own self-interest, not trying to set things up with other people. They're not working together in groups. They're just doing their own thing. We end up with a situation where it's as if people are all working together, that they came up with a decision ahead of time and then acted. Now, an example of that is right over there, the pathway cutting to JFK. Right now there's, they put like mulch down, but originally that was just all grass and people wore a path through there. All people acting independently, no plan ahead of time, they're just trying to save a little bit of time going to JFK. Ends up as if they all got together and planned to do that. For you athletes, when you go from Torv to the field house, you know, there's that sidewalk that kind of cuts through that parking lot there at an angle. You guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
So originally, when they like redid the field house and put a parking lot back there, they didn't have that sidewalk in there. People just cut through there all the time. And they wore it down to dirt. And then the school said, okay, well, let's put a sidewalk in through here. So like in the winter, they're not trudging through snow and mud. So it started with this meta-coordination, that these people acting, not trying to create a new path, not deciding to put down a new sidewalk, but just saving some time, ends up as if they planned this ahead of time. And that's what we see with the market. You can think of the market almost, well, economists would say it's like a miracle, but maybe for business people at least would see it as important, that we're able to discover through people acting on their own what people want, how much they're willing to pay for it, whether you as a business can afford to make it, or whether it's just not worth it. These are huge decisions, and if you're working in a business, you guys aren't going to be wasting your time as economists just talking about this stuff. You'll actually be doing it. So this is how you're going to figure out what people want and what you should make. I'll play a clip from this because I've been talking for a while.
What it means to bring knowledge into the conversation?
So what oftentimes is referred to as economic knowledge, or the knowledge problem, oftentimes people refer to what Hayek's talking about, really goes and can be linked back to, and really it's important to link this back to, the calculation debate. And so Oscar Lange and others who fall into this camp of what today we call the market socialists said, look, Mises, you're right, we need some market prices, but we don't need full market prices. That is, we can still have central planning, but we can have markets in final consumer goods and in labor markets. And we'll just do exactly what you all do when you teach students, which is we will tell firms, the planners will, they'll tell firms to set price equal to marginal cost and to minimize average cost. And if you do that, just like the model of perfect competition suggests, you'll get allocative efficiency. Hayek comes in then and says, well, wait a minute. This market socialist argument makes numerous huge assumptions, but it makes one really important assumption, which is that you have access to the cost curves. What Hayek was saying is there is no way for planners to access the relevant economic information. They can do stuff. They can ask people, what do you want, for instance, and people can tell them things and they can produce it. But what Hayek's capturing is that is not capturing the full cost. That is not capturing the cost that economists talk about. The only way to access that knowledge of time and place, that context-specific knowledge that Hayek talks about in most detail in his 1945 paper, The Use of Knowledge in Society, is through markets. And for instance, Hayek uses an example where he says, look, imagine the price. Okay.
So quick pause. He talks about a lot of higher order stuff. The thing I want you to focus on is it's easy for us to look at the markets, look at maybe one particular industry and say, boy, we should do more of this. We should have more of this product or less of this product. We should have less pollution. But to actually figure out how much is the right amount, not just general like, oh, this looks like too much to me, is very difficult and requires a lot of knowledge. And it's just not possible to gather so much of this as like an individual central planner or like a small central planning board. It's like overseeing an economy.
Can increases. Economic actors do not have to have any gauge whatsoever as to whether the price of tin increased because of demand side influences or supply side influences or both. They will change their behavior accordingly. And so what he's capturing in that story, that illustration, is that prices both capture this context specific information and communicates it to people extremely efficiently. Now, many people misinterpret Hayek and they act as if, okay, if we just have enough computing power, if we just engage in enough search, for instance, to collect the relevant information, then we can do it. So we can have some kind of algorithm. For instance, Amazon, puts up recommended books on your page when you log in, on your account page, based on your previous buying behavior. And people say, well, why can't we just replicate that kind of thing to produce paper towels or coffee? We can just do the same thing. But that misses out on Hayek's fundamental point, which is, there's knowledge you can't capture. There's the opportunity cost aspect. There's daily, nitty-gritty information that you can't capture. For instance, I'm sure most people have heard of an organization that loses someone that's worked there for 15 and 20 years or 20 years. And it could be in the most, roles that are considered relatively menial. So you might say, oh, that's an administrative assistant. We can replace an administrative assistant. That's quite easy to do. There's lots of people that have that basic skill set. But then the new person comes in. And it's not that they lack the necessarily lack the basic skills of how to do administrative activities, but you say, how do I get X done? Who do I go to see this? And they won't know. Where the previous person would have said, well, I know exactly how to get that done. You see this person, you see that person, and you can accomplish your end. That's the kind of local knowledge that Hayek was talking about. That's the kind one aspect of the local knowledge that Hayek was talking about. And those type of things cannot be captured by search. It cannot be captured by, you know, hiring more people with PhDs and having them sit down.
All right, what do you guys think of that? Do you think he's underweighting the potential of AI? The potential of, he says, increased computing power. But our much greater ability to gather data than just 5, 10, 15 years ago? I think he underweights that a little bit. I'm not going to say he's wrong, but I think there's more potential there than he's willing to admit at this point. The biggest problem that he mentioned towards the end is opportunity cost. Because, remember, they're subjective. We all face we have different wants and needs and face different choices. So we all have different opportunity costs for whether it's goods, services, whatever. So that can be very difficult to try to use a machine learning algorithm, try to use some fancy computing thing to figure out.
And figure out complex algorithms and so on. It has to be discovered, as Hayek said, anew each day in through the market. And that's the reason behind his emphasis on the knowledge aspect of economic activity.
One of my favorite works by Hayek is The Constitution of Liberty from 1960. And in there, he describes what you're talking about as civilization progressing because people are able to take advantage of knowledge that they don't actually possess. So that's what you're talking about there at this large institutional level, right?
That's exactly.
Pretty much done there. So something they kind of got at the end is prices aren't perfect. You mentioned height that we have to discover new each day. That things are constantly changing. Our wants and needs are changing. The conditions around us are changing. And we're constantly discovering new knowledge. Whether it's finding out about a new product, finding out there's a product out there that meets our need that we didn't know about in the past. Maybe someone, a business is creating a better good than in the past or found a cheaper way to make it. All these things are constantly happening. So if we have, that's not a permanent marker. We'll talk about this later, a supply and demand curve. Supply, this is how many of a particular good businesses are offering. This is how much, this curve represents how much a consumer wants. That's not going to be static. It's not going to be staying here day after day. It's going to be constantly moving. So we'll have the supply curve moving back and forth and the demand curve moving back and forth. Constantly as new goods are being offered, as people's tastes are changing, as they're finding out about new products. As their friends buy something, and it turns out, hey, that thing's really cool, I think I want one too. Little things like that, constantly changing in society, and prices are changing to reflect that. Now, a lot of times, as consumers, we don't see these price changes. If you go to the store, it's going to be the same price pretty much every day. And you're going to see these wild swings. But if you look at Uber, how do you guys use Uber or Lyft? An Uber, they say it's going to be a certain price. You wait 5 minutes, it's something different. You're constantly readjusting the price based off of changing supply and demand conditions. And throughout the night, there's a lot of different levels of both demand and supply. So if you're an Uber driver, you don't want to be out at 2 a.m. in the rain. But if it's Saturday, especially like, 2 a.m. Saturday night, you don't want to be out in the rain. You'd rather be at home asleep or be out drinking yourself or doing something fun. But if you're like a consumer, a potential rider, you're out of the bar having fun, you really want an Uber. So you have the supply that's very low and demand very high. So you end up with a much higher price than earlier in the night. The higher price is two things. It encourages people to conserve. If they live two blocks away, like, hey, maybe I'll just walk instead. Maybe I'll split with someone else instead of taking my own Uber. And that high price encourages more Uber drivers to stay out. The idea like, man, I really don't want to be out driving right now. I'd rather be in bed. But I can make $50 off one ride. Whereas earlier in the day, maybe that ride would only be like $15-$20. So these are constantly moving. And I think Uber's the best example of that because they give it to you. You can see the price changes live. Now these imperfections, these imperfect prices, attract entrepreneurs. Now when you take Fry's marketing class, he's gonna talk about entrepreneurs a lot, but I'm gonna talk about entrepreneurs as well because they serve a very important role in economies. So they can earn a profit, they can make a lot of money by meeting consumers' needs better than is currently being met. So if you look at Amazon, when Bezos started the company, it was just an online bookstore. But that was, you know, back in like 97, that was unheard of. People weren't using the internet for that kind of stuff yet. It was cheap, it was easy, and it was quick. And he could stock more books in his giant warehouse than normal bookstores could. So if you wanted a more niche book, a less popular book, you could get it from there, or you couldn't get it from most bookstores. So he was able to meet consumer needs in a new way. Again, this is very cheap to do this because he, you know, pinches pennies on logistics, does everything as efficiently as possible. But he's able to have a greater number of books and deliver fairly quickly. So this is a potential profit opportunity for him. And people have this natural tendency to try to discover unrecognized profit opportunities. Maybe you and your friends kick around an idea for a new app. My friend had one the other day, and now I'm blanking on it. It was pretty dumb, but it was funny. Damn it. All right. When they recognize this way, this profit opportunity, hey, we can make money here, they work on a way to solve that problem. What can we actually do to, like, reach this goal? When they do get that, when they're right, they end up earning profits for themselves. And they make society better off. They're now providing this new good or service that wasn't available in the past, or a better version of a good or service that was there in the past. Makes them better off, makes all society better off, because society has this new thing. Their needs are being met better. So we have the aggregate and disperse economic knowledge, that signal, like I said, and then the incentive. They encourage people to try to solve these problems. So they help, prices help drive discovery. There's a really high price for a good, an entrepreneur, or someone working within one of the firms. They say, hey, I think we can do this cheaper. If we can make it cheaper, we can sell at the same price, though over time it's going to be eaten down, and earn a greater profit. So when you see the high price for a good, it may be annoying, but it encourages more firms to enter, more firms to begin competing. It encourages that initial firm to increase their production and encourages lower price goods later. If you look at the price of flat screen TVs, the original ones were like this big maybe, like $1,000 for one of those. But before long, you can now get like really nice ones like 54-inch screens at Walmart for like $150 if you go at the right time. It becomes much, much cheaper over time. Because once they discover this new product and hey, this is better than what was there in the past, they say, okay, how can we make this cheaper so we can earn a greater profit? So what happens is in the real world, we have, it's imperfect. It's far from the ideal. There's some way out there to combine all the resources we have that would make everyone in the world as well off as possible. You know, a perfect situation where no one can be made better off. Hard to actually imagine that because of how far away we are from it. But there is that level of perfection out there. Because we have this ignorance, we're not sure how to do it. We haven't discovered how to make these goods or services yet. We don't know what they are yet in a lot of cases. We end up with imperfect prices, and we end up with this imperfect world where there's goods and services out there that we could have that we don't. But these imperfect prices provide entrepreneurs with a profit opportunity. And you know, you can go out there, if you offer this, you can figure out how to meet this need. So whether it's a new product, new service, what have you, there's a profit opportunity. You can make a lot of money for yourself. And then there's a feedback that prevents errors from continuing. And that's what we're gonna talk about next. Before we do a little bit more on entrepreneurs, oh yeah, okay. So you guys have any examples of entrepreneurs? Someone who recognized the need and then created a new product or a better product to solve it?
Dude wipes.
Dude wipes? Mm-hmm. What was the need?
Sanitary. I don't really know. Something we need, I guess, we kind of need. Something different.
If he's selling the product, then someone needs it, right?
Yeah.
All right, what else? What are some other examples? It makes more sense if you guys use your own examples than me trying to come up with one off the top of my head. Someone else?
Like the one
cup
wine.
Is that the wine glass that you pull it just like through the cork?
Yeah, no, it's like they sell like gas stations instead of like getting the whole bottle of wine.
Oh, just like a much smaller size.
Yeah, like you need like one cup. It's like comes in a cup, so it's like its own. It's kind of like a beer bottle, except like you just flip the tin foil off of it and then you drink it.
So that's cool. I haven't seen that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, people just want a little bit of wine. They don't want to have to like store the rest of it.
Yeah.
That's clever. Any other ideas, examples? All right. So there's a reading on Canvas about information, what's it called, information and prices. It's like an op-ed length, so it's like 800 words maybe. So not too long to read. Don Boudreau, I showed a video of him earlier in the class. He basically runs through these ideas. So there's unexploited opportunities in the economy. There's these chances we have because of the imperfection, because we don't have all this knowledge. We don't know what the best products are, the best way to make them yet. Because these are out there, entrepreneurs have a chance to earn a profit, that they can create these goods or just figure out a better way to create these goods, and they can earn a bunch of money from doing that. Once we get to the textbook, it's going to ignore a lot of this process. I'm going to try to inject it as much as I can throughout there, but this is why I'm focusing on it in the beginning now. Because so many times we look at this market, we say, all right, this is equilibrium, those two curves cross. That's where it's going to be. Let me call it a day. We don't talk about how, like, the role the entrepreneurs play, about this change in the market over time, evolving to providing better goods and better services for people, meeting these needs that weren't met before. And this process is what we see in the real world. We see new stuff popping up all the time. We see these, you know, read stories about these entrepreneurs being super successful. They'll do a bunch of case studies about FedEx and about, you know, FedEx was the one where the guy got like a D or something on his, in his business class for creating the idea. He said, oh, hell with this, and went out and started the business. You talk about stuff like that. Economics gets really boring and unuseful if we don't talk about it. Now, these unexploited opportunities that he mentions in this is another word for market failure. Market failure is when markets don't improve the human condition as much as possible. When there's unmet needs out there, when it's not the best it could be, that's a market failure. So entrepreneurs, their role in the economy is to improve the functioning of the market, to bring these new and better products to the market and meet humanity's needs. So remember, they're not just profiting for themselves. They're not just making themselves richer. They're doing that, but they're also making other people better off, providing these new things for them. So it's the fact that the market has all these errors, that it has all these better potential products out there that we don't have right now, that allows entrepreneurs to have this function, allow them to improve their lives. There's two types of entrepreneurship I want to briefly touch on. There's one, Israel Kirzner's idea of discovery, and Joseph Schumpeter's idea of creative destruction. So Kirzner's discovery idea is that entrepreneurs create this new idea, they build on top of old ideas and make these better products using the same sorts of things. So they, you know, the internet becomes widespread, businesses start using that. So they're able to, order goods from their suppliers more easily, cheaper, they know when they're coming. So they can do this at a lower cost than faxing their orders or mailing their orders. That makes it function more smoothly. They can offer goods and services over the internet. It's building up new ideas on top of old ideas. Rather than destroying industries, you're creating new and bigger industries. On the other hand, Joseph Schumpeter, writing earlier, talked about creative destruction. So one new industry destroys the old industry. Creative destruction can be painful to go through, but in the long run, it's much better. So during the Industrial Revolution, it destroyed the old methods of production and some of the old goods and services being offered. And there was a lot of social upheaval during the Industrial Revolution, a difficult time to live through. But through this creative destruction, we provided all these new products that were previously unavailable. We made the world a much better place because of it. We see this now as we're moving from a manufacturing economy in the US in like the 1950s through a service economy, now going into the information economy, where we're focused more on technology. So old industries are dying out in favor of these new industries, or for the same old industries, but now using much more technology that doesn't involve people or needs fewer people. So again, we're destroying these old industries. Very difficult to go through, especially if you're working in an industry. But in the long run, it's great. It's providing goods and services either at a lower cost or better ones that are displacing the old ones. You think maybe with Tesla and their electric cars, possibly putting the old auto manufacturers out of business. That might be a future example of creative destruction. They could be wrong. Maybe electric cars will suck compared to more fuel efficient regular cars that use gas. Right now it's up in the air. We're not sure about that yet. So we'll need the market process to signify to us which one is better. So any economic analysis that leaves out either of these two potential types of entrepreneurship is flawed. So you're not getting the full idea. You're not getting the full understanding of what's happening. So this market failure that I mentioned, this market failing to live up, the economy full of errors, it's reason for either government intervention to step in. There's too much pollution, you can have the government step in and mandate less pollution, force businesses to shut down or raise their prices, something to reduce it, or it's opportunity for someone to innovate and profit. Maybe they figure out a better way to produce these goods and services, something that has less pollution. Maybe it's an electric car versus the normal type of car most people drive. So either of these are potential solutions to this imperfect world we live in, to the market failures. This is taken straight from the textbook. It gives definition of an entrepreneur. I really like the quote from Henry Ford here. So entrepreneurs often create products that their consumers didn't even know they wanted. So Ford said, if I asked my customers what they wanted, they would have said a faster horse. Rather than just looking at, okay, what do people say they want? What do they imagine their needs are? coming up and creating a product that fulfills a need, sometimes that they didn't even know they had. They didn't have a desire for automobiles. Normal people didn't have a desire to fly back then. It wasn't a thing that was thought possible. It might not have even been in their imagination. I mean, there was stuff about flying. I mean, there's stories that go back to like ancient Greece about people being able to fly, figuring out a way for flight. But automobiles, a horseless carriage, probably seemed crazy to most people. And something to point out, there's a lot of risk for entrepreneurs. Oftentimes they fail. A lot of new businesses don't end up succeeding, because it's very difficult to know ahead of time what people want. So when entrepreneurs, you know, they have this idea, they find this market failure, they think they can exploit with this new product, they don't have knowledge ahead of time whether it's going to work or not. Only through actually offering that good or service do they know whether it or not it meets those needs, whether or not people actually want it. People can say they want it. They can go around, do market research, and yeah, a ton of people say this would be a great product, and then very few people actually go and buy it. You don't know until you're actually in the market yourself. So there's a lot of personal risk there. And here's some examples of entrepreneurs. So the market, this process that we have, the goal is to maximize human material well-being. When I say, you know, like the markets, whatever, make people as well off as possible, I'm talking about in a material manner. I'm not talking about making people like truly happy, not meaning society's the best from, say, a religious standpoint, but saying from a material standpoint, making sure they have all the goods and services, the things they actually need to survive and to be happy. You know, the market can't really provide companionship or something like that, but it can provide you with the things to make you happy and to help you survive. So again, I'm writing this down and saying this because I want to drive this home, is that the market is dynamic. It's constantly occurring. It's not just those two curves standing there. So prices are constantly changing. Firms, when they're buying their resources, they see this a lot more than consumers actually see. Depending on like what day or maybe what hour of the day they're buying, the resources they need to create those goods and services are changing in price. Firms are very slow to change prices because if you increase prices, you know, it takes consumers off. They get pretty annoyed by that. So even if it drops slightly, they don't want to like give them savings for like that afternoon, then have to raise them back up the next day. The next day you're like, hey, what the hell? Like, it was cheaper yesterday. Think of how annoyed you get with gas prices constantly changing. And that sort of idea. Also, there's a cost to changing prices. If you're a restaurant, you have to print up a new menu every time it changes. That can be costly. So you don't end up seeing those change of prices. Businesses try to smooth it out. So it appears as if the market isn't as dynamic as it really is. But in fact, the actual equilibrium price is changing constantly. I don't want to focus on the static analysis. We will be doing some of it later when we work with these supply and demand curves and we shift one or the other. But in general, curves are constantly shifting because there's constantly new knowledge being discovered, new products being offered, people's demands are changing. What the best allocation of resources is, the best way to combine what we have to make people as well off as possible, is constantly changing. And it's emerging from the market process. So that's how we discover it. There's entrepreneurial successes and failures. Firms, entrepreneurs create these new goods, bring them to the market. They can either do well or they can fail. They'll earn a profit or a loss. And profit or loss tells you how good these goods and services are, whether they're meeting needs or not. And over time, we build up this new knowledge. Okay, it turns out that product wasn't good. Or, oh, this is actually awesome. People love it. We didn't expect them to like it so much. that could solve new problems and maybe create their own problems, new problems that entrepreneurs have a potential, your opportunity to solve. So we see prices changing. So Valentine's Day is coming up. Roses are a very common gift, but you know they're not going to be growing out here on the mall or anything in the Red Oak in the winter. So we have to buy it from elsewhere. We have to import it from a warmer region, or maybe there's greenhouses in the area that can do it. There's a lot higher demand for roses around Valentine's Day than most of the year, than a month before or a month after. So we end up with these, you know, these high prices. Annoying for consumers, but it encourages producers to grow more roses. But think about it, if there wasn't a higher price, if they left it at the normal year-round price, there wouldn't be the normal amount of roses. You know, people don't order that many roses throughout the year, but there's a lot more people that want them. So this higher price encourages producers to grow more roses and make them available specifically for Valentine's Day. Now, a lot of us, we think, you know, it's simple. A firm should know ahead of time that people like roses on Valentine's Day. But that's because we've been working with this, with the market for all this time. We know this, we have the signal and the incentive. So firms are shown, hey, like people really want to buy roses right now. The places selling have to like jack up the prices. And they say, hey, like we can afford to expand our, expand the greenhouse. We can afford to ship these farther from a warmer place. And they have the incentive to because they can earn a profit from it. So without prices being able to increase, without the knowledge that's being provided by these prices, we wouldn't have so many roses on Valentine's Day. We'd end up with a shortage. So now profit, from an accounting standpoint, it's revenue minus the cost of production. But in an economic sense, and what we really want to focus on here, is a firm earning a profit, so the revenue being greater than the cost of production, is evidence that consumers are receiving value from a good or service. Firms know that if consumers are willing to pay much more than it costs, that this is a really good use of these resources. Now, it's going to encourage more production by both the firm, and hey, we can produce more, and other firms to offer the product. So the example I have here is a bunch of seltzers. Hard seltzers were around for like a couple years. I think White Claw and Truly were like the first two. All of a sudden, like 2 years ago, they took off and became super popular. Now White Claw and Truly wasn't prepared for this, so there were shortages for a while. And what do we immediately see afterwards? Everyone else started offering hard seltzers. Four Loko came out with one, which is nuts. Bud Light came out with one. Natty came out with one. Corona came out with one. All these different beer companies and beer brands started offering them because they saw White Claw and Truly earning such amazing profits, or profits, I guess, per unit, because they weren't selling. The number of seltzers they had sold out. They weren't expecting to sell that many. They saw this opportunity to profit, so they jumped in the market. And of course, White Claw and Truly, because of how much money they were making, they said, hey, we know people want this. We got to start making more of it. So this profit for a particular like new good, or fairly new good, as demand changes and increases, not only encourages that firm to produce more, it encourages other firms to produce that product, to jump in the market and start competing. Without profit, we'd see fewer firms offering these hard seltzers. We wouldn't see everyone jumping into the market. We wouldn't see White Claw and Truly, increasing their level of production. But very important role being served by profit. And again, because there's this subjective value, it's not that consumers are being taken advantage of because the price is greater than the cost of production. Profit is this evidence that people are getting even more value from this particular good than the cost of making it. So it's a signal that these firms are creating value. On the other hand, loss has a very important function as well. So it's earning a negative profit, so your costs are going to be greater than the revenue you're taking in. It's a pretty shitty situation to be in if you're a firm. What it does is discourage a firm from selling a good or a service. Because firms face a hard budget constraint, because they can go out of business if their revenue is too low, their creditors, you know, demand money back, or people, the owner just can't keep pouring more money into the company, they're discouraged from producing and trying to sell goods or services that earn them a loss. So if you're a firm, you're earning a loss on this one particular product, what you do is you stop producing it. You redirect those resources to some other usage where you're actually earning a profit. Or maybe you stop producing that and you enter a whole new industry. You start producing hard seltzers instead. For the Office fans, when Michael brings in the founder of the company, I forget if it was Dunder or Mifflin, and he starts telling the story about how they started making ingots, and then he just kind of goes off on a thing. They made other products before they made paper. Over time, I guess they discovered that those metal ingots or whatever weren't earning them very high profit, but they could get into the paper business and make a decent amount of money. So they recognized, you know, there's a loss in this one industry. It's not worth it to continue, but they could earn a profit somewhere else. And that's what firms need to recognize. And that's what profit and loss provides for them. And once you jump into that offering that other good or service that consumers actually want, then you can start earning a profit. And again, an incentive for you to keep making more of it and a signal that you're doing the right thing. So instead of just going around and asking consumers, is this good? Is this bad? Are we doing what you want? Is there a better thing we could do for society? You're explicitly being shown on your financial statement. So loss is painful. This is like going bankrupt and shutting down is painful. Firing people as you need to go into a new line of production is painful, but it improves the economy and it helps people get more of what they actually need. So we can be sad about people losing their jobs, about the hardship that causes. I'm not pretending it doesn't, because it does. But everyone else in society is being made worse off by keeping them in their jobs, producing something that people don't want. It may seem, not terrible if it's just like one product, but it's going throughout the economy, producing all these things that people don't want. We're wasting a ton of money and making everyone worse off than they could be. Here's a couple terrible products. The first is the Ford Edsel. It was so big and so ugly that this car from, I think it was the early 60s, ushered in the first age of like small compact cars in the US. Like cars that were like half its size. It was so bad, it completely changed demand in the whole industry to how much people hated it. Next is New Coke. Everyone hated New Coke when it came out. So much that Coke had to go back to the old recipe after like a couple months. Again, very strong signal that Coke got that like people immediately stopped buying Coke and switched to Pepsi. They lost a ton of money off that. So they had, again, signaled in the incentive that, hey, we're going to go out of business soon if we keep this shit up. The next is Lay's Wild Potato Chips. I Googled, terrible products, and this one came up. I never heard of it before this, but it was, like, some kind of special, like, low-fat potato chip that they had some sort of special trans fat or something in. So it kept the taste, normal potato chips. But what it did, like the fat couldn't be absorbed by the body. So like, I don't know, you're not taking it in. So body would just, you know, get rid of it. Unfortunately, what that does is cause people to have diarrhea all the time. Which, shockingly, people didn't like to do to themselves. Apparently Taco Bell's okay, but these potato chips were just like over the line. And the last one is that one Samsung that kept blowing up and exploding like in people while they were talking on it. Yeah, people aren't going to like that. They're going to stop buying that. They figured out, hey, we need a more reliable product that doesn't injure our consumers. So if you're a firm, firm, and you see one of your competitors making a product that's doing very well, it's kind of similar to what you offer, but different enough that people aren't going to be willing to buy yours instead. What are you going to do? I think this is more useful for you than me talking about cost curves and shit like that, because none of you guys are going to be economists. They're producing something that you're not making and they're doing really well at. Are you just going to ignore that opportunity or are you going to take advantage of it? Yeah, you jump and you say, hey, I can make some money here. So you step in and do that. Meanwhile, if you're earning a loss, or say your competitor's earning a loss on a good, they introduce something new and you're like, hey, I want to keep an eye on that. Maybe consumers will like it, maybe they won't. Turns out they don't like it. Company starts earning a loss. Are you going to start producing that new thing? If you've already started, typically what happens is like a firm introduces something first and other ones or competitors are working on it. You see that's not working? You're like, well, no, I'm not. They shut it down immediately. Apple had a bunch of failures back in like the 80s and 90s, trying to be the first to offer something. It always went wrong. So after a while, they said, all right, well, let's just stop doing this. They would always let someone else be the first to introduce a new product. It would bomb and have several problems. They'd look at it and say, okay, people don't like the way the screen looks. It's like very difficult to read. All right, we'll make our screen better. They don't like this particular function. Okay, we'll nix that. They don't like the size. Okay, we'll make it so it fits in people's hands naturally instead of being a square. And then they would come out with the product and it would blow everyone's minds. Like the first MP3 player, they weren't the first to create an MP3 player, but they were the first to make a good one that consumers actually liked because they learned from other people's mistakes. They saw that there was this profit opportunity, but they weren't sure the best way to seize it. So before we end, I'll just point out the last two lines there. Knowledge is discovered and then acted upon, but it's costly to acquire. Research and development is a huge chunk of a lot of firms' budgets, in particular industries, because trying to figure out what the consumer needs are, how to actually create the thing that meets those needs, that can be very expensive, very time consuming, very difficult to figure out. So the reason why the world isn't better, why we're not offering better goods and services right now, is because of how difficult the process is of figuring it out. There's a reason why I'm standing here talking and not an entrepreneur running my own business. Because it's hard and I don't have that idea. If I did, I probably wouldn't be here. If you guys had that idea already, you wouldn't be here either. Maybe you had that idea and you're like, I want to learn some business stuff first. But I don't like crash and fail initially because I don't know how to like do accounting. But in general, if you don't have that idea, you're not going to be out there doing it because it's a long process to figure it out. To understand an industry, understand people enough to know how many, in general, like if a ton of people want it or if no one wants it, figure out how to make it, all that kind of stuff. It's costly, it's difficult, but if you do it right, you're earning a huge profit and make society better off at the same time.